Good morning, everyone. Following the set of discourses that we had last evening and then the very stimulating conversation this morning, we move to a panel discussion with a question that in some senses frames this year's dialogue and frames perhaps the public discourse in many countries currently, which is the question of whether globalization is in reverse or not. And whether it is or not, is that a good thing or a bad thing? What might its implications be? And so my friends and colleagues at Gateway House asked me to moderate the panel, so I should start by thanking them for inviting me. My name is Rohinton Medhora. I'm with the Center for International Governance Innovation, CG, just outside Toronto in Canada. We have a very eminent panel that will help us of converse on the subject. To my left, Yonov Frederick Agah from the WTO, Dennis Snauer from the Kiel Institute, Dilip Pathak from Warburg Pincus, Mukund Rajan from Tata Sons, and Ashok Malik from the Observer Research Foundation. And they have detailed and very impressive biographies in your package. I won't go through those in detail other than to simply sort of acknowledge their presence and their affiliation at this point. I guess by way of introduction, and there's a couple of papers in your package on this as well, it might be helpful to think about whether globalization is in reverse or not, whether that's a reflection of underlying attitudes or whether it is something else, exogenous, such as technology, and what the interplay between those two might be. And then, of course, the all-important question of what the implications of that might be. And there's different views, I know, in the room and on this panel on that. So what we'll do is we'll talk among ourselves for about 45 minutes, then we have 15 minutes for discussion with you, and then we will come back and have closing statements, or not statements, actually we have a question for each of our panels at the end, panelists at the end as well. So if it's okay, Mukund, I'm going to start with you, representing India's face of the private sector in some ways to globalization, and ask each of you the same question, but start with you, Mukund, on how, from where you sit, have you seen globalization unfold in the past 20 years or so? And what, if anything, has changed recently for you?
Sure. Thanks, Rohinton. I think for the Tata Group, really, globalization has been one of the most critical explanations of the success that we've enjoyed. Just to give you some data points, at the start of the 1990s, just when India was liberalizing, we were a few billion dollars in turnover with practically no foreign footprint or significant business. Where we are today is over $100 billion in turnover, with 70% of that actually being generated in markets outside our home market of India. In the early 90s, soon after liberalization, you may recall this construct called the Bombay Club, which was supposed to be Indian industrialists who sought more time and a calibrated opening up of the economy for Indian industry to be able to compete. We actually were not part of that club. We welcomed the opening up of the economy because we thought India's time had come and you really needed to be able to compete with foreign majors in India to be able to succeed in global markets, and we thought this was actually an opportunity for the country. It wasn't easy. We had to make significant investments in quality development programs and systems and processes and human resource talent. But through the 90s, I think we did a good job of investing to really gear up to tackle foreign competition in India, so much so that we developed the confidence to actually expand overseas, including through acquisitions, but also organic growth. In this entire phase, I think there are two or three interesting milestone events. So for instance, in the 90s, I think the biggest single factor that explained the Tata Group's ability to compete was our adoption of the Malcolm Baldrige quality framework, which, if you recall, was the United States' own means to equip their companies in the 80s to see off the challenge from Japan Incorporated. we adapted that quality program to Indian conditions, and that was a very important way in which we were able to benchmark with the best of the world and improve our quality systems. In the 2000s, I think significant ambition that drove us overseas. We felt if we could defend our home market against foreign competitors, we could compete equally overseas. And I think globalization meant that you had access to foreign markets. You were able to make acquisitions in all across the world, in South Korea, in the United Kingdom, in the United States. We did the largest leverage buyout of Tate Lee Tea in 2000, and that presaged a whole series of foreign acquisitions. Also, our most successful company through this period has been an IT company, and you will recall the Y2K issue, which really was perhaps one of the milestone events in really giving us a significant fillip to Indian IT industry. And TCS, which is today the largest market cap company in India, I think leveraged that extremely well. So I think we've seen at different points of time in the last 20 years, a series of events that have really encouraged and pushed us to expand. And we've grasped those opportunities strongly. And I think for us, globalization has been really a very important element in our success over the last 20 years. The last couple of years, your question about where we see things, we are concerned. I think you are seeing with issues like Brexit, with some of the rhetoric around the Trump administration, the way they're going to deal with their borders, border taxes, and so on. If market access becomes more difficult, or if you have more unpredictability and uncertainty about how countries are going to collaborate and provide a stable environment for corporates to operate, obviously is of great concern to us. It is, however, a phenomenon that we've seen picking up in the last 8 or 10 years, certainly since the financial crisis. So I think a lot is going to depend on the politicians today and how all of us in the corporate world, other stakeholders can support them to ensure that the system doesn't disintegrate under each country looking out only for its self-interest and abjuring global cooperation. The last point I'd like to make is the benefits of globalization have been so important for Tata's that we've actually written into our code of conduct a commitment, and I'll just read out the clause. It says, we will be committed to support the development and operation of competitive open markets and the liberalization of trade and investment in each country and market in which we operate. So that really is now part of the Tata DNA, and we hope we can continue to support that.
Yeah. I thought your penultimate point is a good one, not least because I agree with it, but that the trend in the sort of changing of the contours in globalization isn't just something that began last June, but might be longer term, and we might come back to that as well. Dilip, same question to you. How have you seen globalization unfold, and what if anything, has changed?
So by way of background, my involvement has been through private equity. And exactly 20 years ago, I joined the oldest, arguably the oldest private equity firm in the world. And exactly 20 years ago, that firm had a business which was about 85% in the United States, 15% in Europe. And I don't think many of our partners even knew where Asia is. I joined them in 94, and to go ahead the new Asia business. We have got to, and at that point in time, I think if you sat around, saw the partners around the table, there was probably one woman in the partnership and no foreigners. Certainly no foreigners from outside Europe and the United States. Today, you know, we're a transformed firm. We were the first, probably the first firm to make a major foray globally. Today we have half our business in the United States and half our business outside the United States. Half our professionals are from outside the United States. 10% of our business is in Europe. 10% of our business is in India. 15% of our business is in China. And 5% of our business is probably in Africa and Brazil. Totally transformed firm. We have, during this period, seen ups and downs, but I have to say that this has been one of the most, we have seen over the last 30 years now, not over 20 years, one of the most amazing periods of wealth creation in the world. This is when globalization has probably been at its best over the last 40 years. And during this period, now let me just step back for a moment. Let me just remind you what has happened over the last 30 years or so, and why we see a slowdown, which we are inclined to look at as a reversal, but it is not. Over the last 30 years, interest rates in America, prime 30 years ago, was at 19%. Today, interest rates are close to zero. Now, of course, they're going to head back up. When interest rates fall, stock markets boom. We have seen a huge generation of wealth in the West during this period. This has converged with the rise of China and growth in China and a huge demand for commodities in China. Now what we have seen over the last few years, particularly, well, not few years, but 2008, the Western financial world, the Western world almost blew up. This was the greatest downturn since the Great Depression. So obviously a huge amount of value destruction took place. So also there's been a slowdown in China, which has led to a dramatic drop in demand for commodities. So what you see then are figures of trade as a percentage of GDP being sort of flat. This we are now interpreting as a reversal of globalization. This is not a reversal of globalization. This is a typical boom-bust cycle, which in nations happens every 8 or 9 years. But when you look at the global economy, it happens every 40 years or so. The global economy waxes and wanes, and that is what we have seen. As far as India is concerned, we have seen that in India, India frankly has not been a huge player in the globalization scene. India's trade as a percentage of global trade is somewhere like 2%. It's 10% for China. I think rather than view this negatively, I think this is a huge opportunity for India. Just as the world is backing off a bit, here is an opportunity for India to seriously engage with the world and increase employment through trade, which is something it desperately needs to do. Thanks.
It might also be that by not being a major player, it's not in the crosshairs of the anti-globalization crowd. So take your point. Dennis, you're the academic observer of this all. What do you think?
I will take a rather different stance. I believe that the nature of globalization has changed fundamentally recently, and it has gone through changes in the past. And the problems that we experience now are the result of our residing in conceptual structures that are now obsolete. Let me explain. In the 18th and 19th centuries, and even before, globalization took the form of trade between countries, mercantilism, and competition among countries, exporting, importing nations, became a test of a country's health. Then in the 20th century, particularly mid-20th century, we found the rise of multinational firms. And now globalization became something that concerned trade that extended across national boundaries, but it was something that firms drove. Goods and services did not just flow between countries, they flowed within firms across national boundaries. And with the IT revolution, logistics improved enormously, and this trade across boundaries, across national boundaries within firms, became more and more important. And now, more recently, since the 1980s in particular, globalization involves not just trade of goods among countries, not just trade of goods and services within firms across national boundaries, but it involves the exchange of knowledge. Originally, it was just an improvement in terms of our communications, mobile phones, faxes, and so forth. But now, more recently, in this millennium, we have the digital revolution, and this digital revolution improves not only our means of communication, so transport of knowledge within and among firms, but it also improved the productivity of machines. And this productivity of machines is growing more or less at a rate determined by Moore's law. Everything doubles within 2 years. And that's, even if it's going to be slower than that in the future, it's a lot faster than human beings are able to learn and assimilate knowledge. So the new competition comes more from between humans. With the exchange of knowledge, it was possible to reallocate labor flexibly between countries in order to take advantage of new profit opportunities. Now, with the rapid improvement of productivity of machines, there'll be a new reallocation of labor, some of it going back to the countries from which it came. But it means that we need to rethink our strategy with regard to globalization. So President Trump's popularity and the forces that generated Brexit rest, in my opinion, on a fundamental misdiagnosis of globalization. What we have is, in a world in which goods flow freely across national boundaries within firms and knowledge across firms, tariffs are basically an obsolete influence. At the time when countries compete, their tariffs could protect. Now, most goods and services are produced in more than one country. So if you erect tariffs, it's like building a wall within a factory. It makes absolutely no sense. Tariffs between the United States and Mexico will raise the costs of intermediate goods to American car producers and thereby hinder these car producers from exporting. So tariffs make no sense. And in addition, offshoring is going to become less important than the new automation, robots, smart machines, and so forth. And so the big push against offshoring that President Trump's popularity rests on is also obsolete. And consequently, I believe we need to get our minds around this new wave of globalization and the appropriate instruments for it.
Let me just second two points Dennis made with factoids. One is there's a long-term experiment that compares the error rate of robots and artificial intelligence for not just basic tasks, but even medium and complex tasks with the error rate of humans. And last year, I believe it was last June or so, was the first time in that study that the error rate for AI was lower than the error rate for humans. So that's one point on which I'm with you. And the other, again, factoid, is that 20 years ago in the S&P index, about 1/5 of its value was embodied in so-called intangibles, 4/5 in tangibles. Today, the ratios have been reversed. So your point about trade in ideas, and I think we'll come to it when we think about what the intellectual property regime underlying trade in ideas might look like, is a very powerful one. So let's hang on to that. And I'm sure Fred has views on whether tariffs are obsolete or not, but hang in there. What do you think? Sure.
Thanks, Rohinton. The most difficult job for an Indian at a meeting of this nature is to stick to time. I hope I do. I have 4 points to make in my 5 minutes. One, globalization has been intrinsic to India's modernization and expansion as an economy in the past 25 odd years. This is not just a cliche, it's actually a coincidence of time. If one looks at accession to WTO as one milestone in a country's journey down globalization, then India acceded to WTO as a founding member in January 1995, which was just 3.5 years after it began to restructure its economy in the summer of 1991. This was very different from, say, the China experience. China's four modernizations began in 78. It acceded to WTO in 2001. So China could sequester those two processes, internal reform, internal restructuring, and globalization, in a manner India could not. This posed challenges for India. It also gave India enormous opportunities. But this is, in a sense, the Indian experience. Globalization is sort of written into the DNA of Indian modernization. Second, since 91, since we opened up our economy, or began to open up our economy in a fitful sort of way, India's GDP has grown about 8 times. In this period, external trade as a percentage of GDP has moved up from 15% to 50%. In real numbers, what that means is in 1991-92, India's external trade, imports and exports, amounted to $40 billion. Today, they amount to $1 trillion. Now, yes, there are discrepancies written into that trade. There are distortions. India doesn't export as much as it imports. India doesn't manufacture enough. We know all of that. But the fact is, $1 trillion worth of external trade drives Indian jobs, Indian aspirations, Indian prosperity. That is how important globalization is to us. What has changed in the past few years? And frankly, this is not just the last year. It's been happening since 2008, maybe even earlier. I'd say that two challenges have come up. One I'd call a quantitative challenge, and one a normative challenge. The quantitative challenge is, frankly, that India, or rather Asia and the West, are looking at globalization very differently. The Asians used to be the transactional globalizers, or our trading partners often complained that India was a very difficult trade negotiator. I think somebody said it earlier in the panel as well, that our tariff barriers remain high, especially for goods. All of that is true. But now we see that transactionalism has become universal. It's not just the Asians who are doing it. The Europeans are also doing it. The Americans are also doing it. One number is interesting. It comes from a Pew Center survey, which takes place periodically every few years in America, on American attitudes towards the world. In 2016, Americans were asked which was more important, Europe or Asia. 52% in 2016 said Europe was more important, and only 32% said Asia was. The previous poll in 2012 had said 47% rooted for Asia and said it was more important, and 37% felt Europe was more important. Those numbers have changed by 15%. Europe has become 15% more important, and Asia has fallen 15%. 2016 represents the first time since 1992 that Americans, as per this poll, see Asia as less important than Europe. And this is reflected in the new attitudes, the new rhetoric we're hearing about trade. It's reflected in the noise and the restrictions we're hearing in terms of Indian services exports, which are of a concern to us. And this is being reflected in what is a lazy and unfortunate conflation of many different terms: refugees, migrants, asylum seekers, and guest workers who have high skills and are temporary migrants. The last category concerns India and is a great valuation for the Indian economy and the global economy. The other categories don't concern India, but unfortunately, in today's world, they all seem to have got mixed, partly because of ILO definition issues, which we can discuss later. So that's one challenge. The space for Indian exports, so this seems to be suddenly smaller than it was. The second challenge is normative. Globalization and the perceived advantages of globalization spurred internal reform, spurred new thinking on tariff barriers in India, perhaps not enough, as somebody suggested, but certainly better than where we were 20 years ago, spurred new thinking in the early 2000s on intellectual property rights and the intellectual property regime in India, and so on. Minus that external pressure or the perceived advantages of engaging with the world, where is the space for that reform? That is a big question mark, and that does concern me. Also, globalization was not just about integrating trade and integrating supply chains. It was also about the globalization of values or ideas, as Dennis put it. It was about a common perception of shared responsibilities for global public goods, for public health, for the environment, for climate change. And this was reflected in, for instance, India changing its position on climate change from being a naysayer, a chronic naysayer, to becoming a part of the solution, which it attempted to do in Paris. So we came to this party late, but we came to it with some enthusiasm. And now we find those who are hosting the party, or began the party, are suddenly less enthusiastic after all these years. So that is a big challenge. And I, if it's not checked and if a compromise is not reached by all stakeholders concerned, it could weaken or contract the space for globalization, the political space for globalization within societies, especially in India. And that does concern me.
Thank you, Ashok. And you know, we've been focused on trade, and I know we will again when Fred speaks, but thank you for raising the question of the role that the movement of ideas and values and the movement of people has played in globalization. We'll come back to that. Fred, you're at the WTO and have seen globalization unfold from that perspective. What do you think?
Well, I think one of the challenges you face speaking last on a panel like this, you tend to repeat what everybody may have said. But I just want to add my own dimension to the conversation. And I take the position that globalization as a process, nothing has changed. What has really changed are the narratives about the process, as well as the responses of governments, people, and institutions to this process. So why do I say this? I say this because, as far as I am concerned, and maybe coming from West Africa, we see globalization as the increasing level of interconnectedness. So when the first Portuguese ship, somewhere around the 15th century, started taking palm oil off our coasts back to Europe, we became integrated. And I'm sure that is true with your region. Secondly, if you look at the drivers of globalization over time, they have remained very strong and changed in character and influenced it. Transportation, improvements, If you look at information and communication technologies, and then if you look at the areas of globalization, is it cultures, the way people share food now, share dresses, even clothing? Is it the climate change movement or environmental movement? Is it the growing civil society movements around and the important role of multinational corporations? So all these you begin to see as the drivers of globalization as it moves. And as it moves, the narratives have continued to change. At the beginning, we were talking about the risks and opportunities of globalization. I remember, is it President Clinton also, said it was a train that nobody will stop. You either join or you are left behind. So how did governments respond? Most of the responses were through domestic policy measures. And these touched largely on that component of globalization that had to do with trade and integration. So those who were able to adjust, countries like India, China, from the developing world as a matter of fact, were able to take advantage of the opportunities of globalization and trade and grow their economies and have lifted millions out of poverty. On the other hand, one of the narratives of globalization that we have refused to accept is the reality of competitiveness. If you want to benefit from globalization, you needed to be competitive. So while the countries in the developing world were trying to adjust, the countries of the North had already developed. So the conversation was different. Trade in the developing world was seen as an instrument of development. Trade in the developed world was seen as liberalization. And these are two different things. Liberalization to deepen the benefit from the use of trade policy as an instrument of development, and those who are adapting their economies to how they can benefit from trade. These are two different things. So today, the shoe is on the other foot. The realities of loss of competitiveness. When the process started, those who had no competitiveness resisted. So today, those who were competitive have lost competitiveness. They have lost market shares. They have lost production facilities. And therefore, the conversation has shifted to where are the benefits going. So you hear issues of fair trade. You hear issues of loss of jobs. You hear issues of closed markets. So my own belief is, how do governments respond to this? Most of our bureaucrats have not been creative enough. So the easiest thing is to blame the outsider, and that is trade or other trading partners. If they had sat down and looked at this evolution and looked at the labor market structures they had, the need for transition, maybe that could have changed the conversation. They could have created new ways of responding. And similarly, if we had looked also at how institutions accept the new differences amongst levels of development and created policies or frameworks that recognize that we are not all the same, that could have made a difference. And I say this because if you look at the trade facilitation agreement in the WTO, where members sat down and crafted different levels of flexibilities depending on how they could benefit or even implement the agreement. That capacity to implement the agreement became critical. So today, for a country like India, it's not just about all the issues. It should be about which issues add most to your competitiveness and benefit from globalization. Otherwise, we can continue this conversation forever. We lose sight of the benefits. If you increase tariffs today, you are not protecting your economy. You are making your consumers to suffer. Because at the end of the day, the exporter will continue to export, but your consumers will pay higher prices. So governments need to look at that. If you build walls and there's no free movement, it's not the other partners that suffer. It is you, the country that has put in those measures, that will suffer. I think the need or the other key element of globalization that should be emphasized is the cooperation among countries to identify solutions to common problems. So all of us have a duty to, in the developed world, show who has benefited from globalization rather than stories of who is losing. In the developing world, we have had so much success stories of benefits of globalization. But I think that is not the conversation. The conversation should be how governments will make the benefits more inclusive. I thank you.
I think, Fred, the points you made about having institutions that are flexible and the role that national policies play in dealing with globalization leads to our next conversation, and this time probably less than 5 minutes each. But this is not new. I mean, I cite in my note that you know him. Adrian Wood wrote in 1995, talking about globalization, that the way to deal with it was to strengthen national responses through education, retraining, social safety nets. And we kind of went for one side of the globalization pie, which was the competitiveness and openness, and didn't shore up national systems. And so that's where the losers arise and then become vocal. Which leads me to this question. You call Europe home, Switzerland, you call Europe home. You shuttle, but UK is home, and the two of you travel a lot. But one could make the point that had the turnout been different, had more young people voted, the Brexit vote would have gone differently. One could make the point that at the end of the day in the popular vote, in fact, Hillary Clinton won by 3 million, and it's the electoral college system that's of, and of course, not everyone who voted for Trump is against globalization, just as not everyone who voted for Clinton is for it. But my question to all of you is, from where you sit, do you sense that the constituency for globalization is smaller or less vocal than before, and are we just seeing an aberration through these electoral processes? Is it the case that in large countries like India and China, the constituency for globalization is strong as ever? In other words, have underlying attitudes changed or not? Let me start with you on that.
Well, maybe I identify the problem, so maybe I should solve it. That is not possible. Because you see, like I said, if you go around this room, you get different kinds of responses. So, my point is, when you look at how governments handle policy, the ideal world is common good, policies that touch people, improve living standards. If you are more interested in building champions, and many of the countries today that you see these different voices build champions. And in building those champions, the lower rung of society were left behind. If you see how you want to benefit from globalization and the sectors that will contribute to your growth, and you begin to develop your roadmap, all we talk about in terms of trade integration are the complementary policies that you put in place. Your policy in technology acquisition, your policy in intellectual property rights protection and innovation, your policy in education, skills developed. These are all kinds of things, and you need to take all the little micro, your best in different sectors, and pull them together in one whole set of common national policies. That helps you to then determine how you can benefit at the regional level or at the multilateral level. But very often, I can tell you, to do this at the national level is one of the most difficult challenges to governments, because in each sector, the players are different along the value chain. And by the time you take that to the global level, it becomes difficult. So people will be left behind, and those left behind can become a good candidates for politicians who play on the discontent in the population to win elections to use. But at the end of the day, the reality of governance will say, well, you have to do the same thing. And so the ball continues rolling.
Dennis, where you sit in Germany, is the constituency different now?
I think the constituency is different now. And I would characterize it as a difference between those who get it and those who don't. There used to be a time, not that long ago, say 100 years plus, when you had a fever, the right thing to do was to get some leeches. When you see these old Victorian films of people with high fever and leeches crawling over them, you sort of think, ooh, this is a bad idea. And now there's something very similar going on. You have people who are afraid of losing their jobs. And they're told the counterpart of take some leeches. Protect yourself with tariff and non-tariff barriers. Whereas those who get it understand that our interconnectedness lies much more in terms of ideas than in terms of goods and services. Goods and services are going to be relocated in the next 10, 15 years, much more in accordance with smart machines, the new technologies going on. It will be the interconnectedness of ideas that will be really important. And ideas are highly complementary across people. So there's a lot to be gained and from interconnecting, and a lot to be lost. And to understand in this new world what you lose, imagine that there were tariffs that prevented people from trading across families. Okay? Then what would happen to all of us? We'd go straight back to the Stone Age, because we are now so interconnected that families by themselves don't have enough knowledge and resources to both produce mobility and clothes and food and so forth. We really need to trade among one another. Well, something similar in terms of our lack of self-sufficiency has happened between countries. And this lack of self-sufficiency in terms of innovation lies in terms of ideas that also need to cross national boundaries. So erecting tariff barriers, and particularly erecting non-tariff barriers, which are far more harmful than tariffs nowadays, is silly, and people simply don't realize it. And therefore, I think the more people get it, students who have experience across different countries, they get it. Business people who travel the world, they get it. But the blue-collar American workers who've never left their state, they have problems, and they are much more susceptible to misdiagnosis. And it is fighting with misdiagnosis that I believe is our major challenge.
Usually in panels like this, it's bankers who are called leeches, but this time it's tariffs that are called leeches. So very good. Dilip, on the question of really, in the UK, do you sense people have changed their attitudes to globalization?
So I would, my perspective, and I'd like to give a minute to the UK and a minute to the United States as well, actually, because the situations are very different. First of all, I don't believe Brexit was about anti-globalization. Britain, unemployment in Britain is not particularly high. Britain's growth rate has over the last few years been probably the highest in Europe. It was not about anti-globalization. One aspect of globalization, it is about one aspect of globalization largely. That has to do with the free movement of people. The elephant in the room, whether it is the United States, whether it is Europe, has to do with immigration. The numbers are mind-boggling. Whilst I'm optimistic overall about globalization, as far as the freedom of people, the movement of people is concerned, there is a genuine problem, and we need to try and understand the fears of the people. It is estimated that there will be about 60 to 70 million refugees heading towards Europe over the next decade or so. This is a figure from the Financial Times. As far as the United States is concerned, yes, in the Midwest, there has been a loss of jobs. Whenever there, and inequality, there has been income inequality. Real incomes have more or less stagnated for the last 20 years. But what one forgets is that this is not all due to the rise of China or the rise of India. There has been a huge increase in non-manufacturing jobs in the United States. Huge increase. At the same time, a lot of the loss of jobs has had to do with technology increases and productivity increases. But this, of course, like Dennis suggested, this some of the subtleties are lost on a guy when he's unemployed. But setting that aside for a moment, I'd like to share with you another aspect, because there is a fundamental clash between business forces and cultural issues. Just a week before the US election, I was at a book launch at the University of Pennsylvania, a book written by Devesh Kapoor on the other 1%. 1% of the population of the United States is Indians, but they account for 10% of the PhDs. One of the things he said was that if you project out, and by the way, Strobe Talbert also mentioned something to this effect at a different gathering. If you project out 25 to 30 years, then about 45, based on trends prior to Trump coming in power, then about 45% of the population of the United States 30 years from now will be Asian, 20-25% will be Latin, and 20 will be white. Now, this again is obviously an untenable situation, and it is no wonder that the Republican Party has cut the numbers for immigration by half. So there is this aspect, which is a genuine problem. I don't know the answers. I'm sure it will be resolved at some point, but it's something that we need to recognize.
Underlying attitudes to globalization. Do you sense that they're changing?
I think definitely. If you think back over the last 25 years, I think there were very powerful voices in favor of globalization around the world, and particularly in the powerful developed countries. Some of this, I think, had to do with the collapse of the Soviet Union, the opportunity to integrate the East European countries into the European Union, the fact that China was opening up, and there was, I think, a mission to really spread ideas of liberal democracy to many of these markets that are beginning to open up and trade, increased economic engagement, diplomatic ties were all seen as part of the vehicles through which you would achieve that. Somebody like Joseph Nye, who talked about interdependence theory, was in the first Clinton administration and played a strong role in shaping State Department's policies in those times. So I think the benefits were clear, and there were strong proponents. Government, corporates certainly, who saw opportunities to expand across markets. I think a lot of that changed with the global financial crisis. You're seeing that, for instance, in the financial system. Banks, many of them have started pulling out of a number of the smaller markets around the world. I saw the other day that HSBC and Citibank have withdrawn from over 24 countries in the last few years. The amount of cross-border financial assets that are held are now significantly lower as a percentage of global output, 20% lower, I think, in the last 8 or 9 years. So people have begun to withdraw, and the voices that are strongly in support of globalization have diminished. You also needed, I think, a strong global proponent, a powerful force that would architect the system. Pre-World War I, you had Britain. Post-World War II, you had the United States. And now again, you're seeing those voices change with the new administration. It's unclear how strongly they feel about having a more interdependent global order. So I think certainly that is happening, and that is the worry and the fear. Countries like India, even China at Davos emerged as the voice of reason. They were literally stepping into the shoes you would have expected the United States to occupy. I think these countries see a strong reason for more engagement. But unless there is something that changes within the developed countries that explains the benefits, the value of globalization, that shifts the narrative, as Fred was mentioning, away from seeing it as the reason for all the problems that they face, for putting a context to some of the issues around nationalism that are rising, for separating the impact of automation from what we are seeing with globalization. Automation is impacting all economies. But a lot of people confuse that as being, responsible for globalization being responsible for loss of jobs, whereas it's actually automation that's doing that. I think that responsibility has to be seized by politicians, the political class in these developed countries. Otherwise, I fear that we are on the beginnings of a precipice that could lead to a situation where no country really benefits. And I think the one issue which we all need to worry about is existential crisis, which I think for the world today is the environmental crisis. There will be no stakeholder who's able to really rally the world around a solution for the environmental crisis.
Yeah, I think the point about credible champions is a good one, because currently anyone who speaks up for globalization isn't seen as credible, but as self-serving. And we need sort of dispassionate voices on that front. And we might come back to that. I'm sure there's a question on it. Ashok?
It's easy to be carried away by the debates of the moment, but none of this is really new. This is not the first wave of globalization. We've had waves earlier. Perhaps not as intense. But each wave of globalization has inevitably seen a pushback. The one in the late 19th century and early 20th century led to a pushback. But each wave has left the world more integrated than before the wave. And that's true for this time as well. Many of the issues brought up in the US election, for instance, are not new. If one looks at post-Cold War US elections, then the two candidates who come across as most skeptical about the benefits of global trade are, of course, Donald Trump in 2016 and Al Gore in 2000. Now, the two are very different men. One's to the left of the US polity, one's to the right, one's Democrat, one's Republican. But they both spoke for, in a sense, the Midwestern blue-collar worker who has swung from one party to the other, one candidate to the other in the past 20 years, seeking answers to the challenges, existential challenges of his life, of why his steel plant has shut down, why his coal mine has shut down, and so on. The case for globalization can be best made if you benefit from it. You are enthusiastic about it depending on whether it works for you or doesn't work for you. This is true for countries, this is true for industries, this is true for families and individuals. Globalization, we often speak in international political economists speak about the global south and the global north. What globalization has ended up doing is brought us face to face with this this phenomenon of a domestic South, which exists now not just in emerging economies and underdeveloped and less developed economies, but frankly, it exists in the West as well. This is the first generation in OECD countries that will be less well off than its parents. This is the first generation in the modern era that will be less well off than its parents. So that is something we have to live with and confront. Finally, I think what the world is facing because of globalization and automation, the two coming together and sometimes spurring each other, is a Malthusian problem, where the commodity in short supply is not food, but jobs. And this is not going to change, because modern technology and globalization, and there's no doubt that integration of economies will continue in some form or the other, will continue to create value, but continue to hemorrhage jobs. So the answer to that is not nostalgia for some era that existed before globalization. The answer is, frankly, in the advocacy of globalization, realizing that they need to create social security nets, not because I want to be charitable, but out of self-interest. Because if I need to create that constituency for globalization, I need to give people something, even if they don't work for it, frankly.
Is this a good time to go to questions?
We have a few questions from the audience. So in the given that the unified global strategy is not working or may not work in the future, do the corporates have to redefine their strategies going further? And what are the areas they should look into in terms of exports?
Do corporates have to redefine their strategy? And if so, how and where? Maybe we should ask the corporates. I'll start with you.
No, certainly, I think every corporate today has to be extremely agile, has to be able and willing to recast business plans literally on the fly. But it's not a good situation where you can't have certainty and predictability about how markets are going to develop. I think the first principle of foreign investment is you need clarity about the policies of the markets you're investing in. If you worry that the basis on which you've architected your supply chain is going to be impacted within a year or 2 years, or at every election point, there's going to be a change in policy, a change in tariffs, a change in visa regimes, it becomes completely unsustainable. Now, one of the answers is for corporates in the home market to solicit the support and the backing of their respective governments, and then the governments to try and architect bilateral arrangements. I think in today's context, that's part of one of the remedies that people are looking at. So if I'm a corporate out of India, can the Indian government back me in, you know, trade relations with neighboring countries, a free trade agreement with the United Kingdom, and so on? That's going to solve maybe some of the problem, but I worry that these are not long-term sustainable solutions. The long-term sustainable solution is one where you have a multilateral framework that all countries participate in and subscribe to, and that doesn't keep changing every time you have a new election, a new regime. So corporates will, as best as they can for their survival, respond to these trends, but it's not a good sign when you have to go back to government for help.
Dilip, did you want to come in on this one?
Yes. These are all thought-provoking issues. The point is, Ashok was talking about being a shortage of jobs in the future. Yes, there are countries in Europe talking about minimum incomes, regardless of employment, etc. I think the nature of jobs will also change. You have investment bankers and consultants who work 70 hours a week. On one hand, you have people in France who work 35 hours a week. The definitions of jobs will change. Maybe more people will be employed and everyone will work 20 hours a week. And why is that so bad when you're at a certain level of economic success? The other thing, of course, is talking of cooperation, just corporations as such. I think as we move ahead, and this is already happening, we can't be compartmentalized in society as individuals and governments and corporations, etc. Corporations also, and some corporations are already doing so, have a larger responsibility. And it's good business. You know, whether they're out educating people, whether they're involved with the environment, whether they're out with, you know, corporations can make a huge difference. And this, you will find this will, they will get increasingly, they will have to get increasingly engaged, because whether it is India or whether it is outside India, in India the problem is jobs. We need jobs. The problems in Europe are different. The problems in Europe are dramatic demographic decline in numbers. How do you deal with refugees? So the problems differ from place to place. But, you know, I think we're all going to have to get over our selfish hang-ups and sort of get pigeonholed, and we'll have to figure out new modes of working together.
Fred, you wanted to come in on this.
Yes, I think coming from the WTO, I think with all these, it's important for business to change strategy. Business needs to be more proactive. Policies shouldn't just be put on you and you begin to struggle to adjust. You need to engage governments to ensure that policies have perspective. The complementary policies that take you to that perspective are also in place. So if it is job and labor transition for workers who may fall out, you know, if it is sectors that are going to lose competitiveness and close down, you should know, because businesses like human beings are born to die. So from a competitiveness and threat cost point of view, I think in the new environment, it's important for business to engage governments. Governments will then give you the policies you need at the national level, and they can give you better agreements that do not threaten your operations in the future.
Another question.
So given that the current you know, automation and the high intelligent machines, these discussions are in the foreground, and given that there's no consensus on whether globalization is in the reverse or moving forward or stalled, what does it mean for Indian jobs? And is there an opportunity for India to be reviewed as a high-value, low-cost workforce, or will the Indian workforce have to pay a price in the long run?
Who wants to take that? Dennis, start with you.
It may seem a bit discordant that a non-Indian starts this discussion, but let me give it a shot. Who does not believe that machines will take over a good deal of routine work in the future? I'm sure most of us are in agreement that that will happen. Much like machines took over a lot of the work that involved muscle power in the first wave of the Industrial Revolution, it will happen. And those people who used muscle power in their work found it probably inconceivable that muscles should not be important at the workplace in the future, but it ceased to become so. And now routine work will cease to become the major domain of human beings. So what does this mean for India? Well, India has big chance to leapfrog in this respect, because Indians have a natural affinity for the new technologies and are often well placed to understand what they imply. If human beings wish to compete with machines whose productivity will double every 2 years and will be performing routine work more and more cheaply, what this means is that those who have a future in the workforce need to be creative, they need to be adaptable, and they need to combine social skills with technical skills. And these are all things that machines are not so well able to do. So that is a huge challenge for education and training. But the most important thing, I believe, is one's mindset. If your mindset is directed towards finding a future in creativity, adaptability, and social skills, then you are well set for the future. And therefore, I think India has a huge possibility, because Western societies, particularly mature Western societies that have strong social nets, are at a disadvantage. People don't have the same incentive to think about what the next stage will be in the future, because there are too many safety nets around them that allow them to give more latitude to their inertia than is necessary. And therefore, those people who understand that creativity, adaptability, and social skills are the thing for the future are the ones who are most likely to acquire them. That's my outlook for India.
You're eligible for a PIO card with that answer, so just like I am. Very good.
Could I be a little more skeptical? You know, in the very long run, India will take care of itself, and India will produce fewer children, and they'll all be employed. But between now and the very long run, there are several elections, there are several debates. There's a two generations have to live. We are now at near the peak of our, whether you call it our demographic dividend or our youth bulge, which by one statistical collation peaks in the year 2030, when we have 450 million people of a population of 1.5 billion who will be aged between 15 and 34. The youngest of that cohort has just been born. The oldest is already a voter. So this is what you're dealing with. All of these people can't get jobs. We are going to be the first major economy in the world that will employ a vast majority of its people in the informal sector. That is a reality. That's a reality not just because of the way our economy is structured. That's also a reality because the big industrial capitalism model that was pioneered in the US and in Germany and then came to Japan and China is now gone. Big manufacturing will happen. India's manufacturing as a share of GDP will go up. But frankly, those factories will create lots of value, but will not create jobs. You look around, you look at Indian automobiles, for instance, which is a great manufacturing success story. The average Tata plant or Mahindra plant employs fewer people today than it did in the 1980s, but creates much more value and more cars. So that is a reality we have to live with. Also, the jobs in India, or let's say the employment opportunities in India, I'm not calling them jobs because the old-fashioned notion of a job is gone. I think it's gone forever. Employment opportunities in India will be created, frankly, by what Ravi Shankar Prasad said yesterday. In services, in digital services, the mom-and-pop stores or the mom-and-pop businesses that come up will not be small welding factories, will be offshoots of the digital economy, using it to create businesses maybe have a small food processing unit outside a farm and then linking it through the internet to a market far away. That's just one example. In fact, that is an example which we have seen manifestations of in recent times. But there will be other such opportunities that will come up. But the old-fashioned notion of a job, I think it's gone forever.
Can we, anyone else on this one?
I would just say that I do agree with Ashok that there's a formidable task ahead. We have to create about 200 million jobs in the next 15 years. I don't think any country has ever done that. I agree with Dennis. We're a very flexible people and adaptable people. But at the end of the day, having technological devices is not enough. You need a solid base of education. We still have a very weak education system here by and large, except for the top 1%. So this is a work in progress. India, the key thing to realize by the government, by the bureaucrats, by the private sector is, like Simon Cooper, one of the journalists of the FT once said, the second time I'm quoting the FT is, for India to succeed,
India's going to have to get everything right. And that's something to think about.
I just want to supplement what both Dilip and Ashok said. But I want to make the point that, and this goes back to globalization and India, in the next 10 years, if you believe government projections, our country will need many trillions of dollars of investment in infrastructure. And therefore, if we get our act right on build out of roads, ports, various kinds of plants, I think there will be some offtake of jobs that will take place for maybe the next 10 to 15 years. But after that, when a lot of the secular trends that are already in place towards automation and so on capture those segments of the economy as well, then you really have the kinds of problems that we're discussing, and inequalities will also significantly increase in society. And the fear would be that it shouldn't play out the way it has in other markets. Now, in the meantime, to get those trillions of dollars of infrastructure investment, India is going to have to rely on foreign direct investment. And therefore, we have to be very much a part of this conversation on globalization to invite foreign investors into this country. We have a strong vested interest in seeing that happen.
Let's take one last question and then wrap up with final thoughts from the panel. And if you want to club two questions, that's fine too.
I have two questions for Mr. Agah, actually. One is from Ambassador Bhatia, that globalization train is stalled and not yet in reverse. But what advice should be given to persuade the critics and the cynics to remove the obstacles?
You said you had two questions?
No, that's it.
Just one. Okay. Do you mind repeating the question, please? That way it sounds like two questions.
What advice would you give to persuade the cynics and the critics to remove the obstacles that we are dealing with today in terms of globalization?
What advice would you give to those who want to sort of put roadblocks in the way of globalization?
Well, I mean, from what I have said, there is nobody who is going to put roadblocks to globalization. Any government, any CEO, any civil society group that tries to create barriers does so at its own risk. That's the point I would want to make. Because since the end of the Second World War, and since particularly the 1980s, average tariffs around the world have virtually disappeared. And many of you who are in India will confirm what I'm saying. Similarly, a lot of non-tariff barriers in the form of subsidies are now being better disciplined in the WTO. The real challenge is for members, civil society, businesses to engage in trying to now look at how rules respond to the changing character of international trade. When we launched the GATT in 1947, everything was about tariffs. Then people started looking at standards and trying to change things. And then you had the Tokyo Round Codes that started looking at different ways that people were doing trade. Today, the way we do trade has also changed. So it is all about trying to go back to the toolbox, renew it, and try to ensure it meets our current circumstance. If you think you cannot make that happen, you lose out. If India, for instance, is interested in services trade facilitation, investment facilitation, it needs to work with other members to achieve those objectives. if Nigeria wants to see domestic subsidies in agriculture eliminated, it needs to work with the members to do that. If those who thought that core labor standards are important want a conversation, they need to accept the challenges other members have in other areas. If you think you cannot, you become a stumbling block on a particular issue, you are unwittingly becoming a stumbling block on other issues that are, you think are not important to you, but the level of interconnectedness, interdependence, and cross-sectoral linkages will always work out in favor of those who think allowing all countries to benefit from globalization will prevail.
Could I ask each of you to address the same question, and that will be our final round because we have to end in 5 minutes or less.
Well, I would just say, I don't want to start targeting specific countries, but I would just say, I sort of beg to differ a bit with Fred here. If you take Theresa May Britain and compare different countries to Britain, which was, to my mind, the most open economy till a few years ago, maybe still.
Crises. You had the Chennai floods in December 2015. I understand it's the second largest insurance event in India's history, over $2 billion of insurance claims. And when corporates get personally affected by the impact of floods coming into their offices, then they start speaking in a very different voice and thinking about these issues very differently. And I think with the environmental crisis, you're going to see more of that. And I think that will also create a constituency that speaks out more ardently about the benefits of globalization. So I know that Fred is hoping that reason will prevail, but I think we need these voices to speak up more often, as we are doing indeed on this panel, and that might hopefully address some of the problems we face.
Ashok, and then we'll end with Dennis, if that's
okay.
Thank
you. Just a couple of points. One, I think the globalization story in Asia will continue apace. The integration of the Asian economies is much more to be achieved. And that will continue. There will be hiccups, there will be negotiation problems, including from India, as Dilip has said, but it will continue. As for the West, especially the US, I think we have to be patient and allow this cycle of politics to run the course. I don't think America can walk away from Asia or from globalization. There is a fundamental paradox where Mr. Trump talks about greater military and political engagement with Asia, but a smaller trade engagement with Asia, which doesn't make sense. If you're shifting gunboats here, what interests are you going to defend if you're not trading? So at some point, he will need to address that paradox, and I can't see America staying away from Asia and the Asia Pacific. So I think we need to wait for this cycle and these passions to subside, maybe in 2 years, maybe in three. But it will happen.
Dennis, the bell has rung.
Okay, very briefly, advice. I believe that people should keep in the back of their minds that obstacles to globalization are merely inefficient when you're basically self-sufficient. So if you imagine you live in a large family that some of whom can knit your clothes and others can take care of other needs, then erecting high tariff barriers may be less efficient because you could probably get this material more cheaply abroad, but it's not the end of the world. But if, like most families, you're interconnected with others, then erecting tariff barriers is suicide. And we are now living in a very interconnected world, with interconnected problems like climate change, financial crises, and so on, that no country by itself can solve. And therefore, erecting these barriers is simply a terrible idea when we're as interconnected as we are. That doesn't mean that we don't have problems. Globalization is great for consumers because it gives them cheaper products, but it's really bad for unskilled workers. And these people need to think afresh. And we probably need some idea like 500 years ago, we said, wouldn't it be great for humanity to become literate? And that helped us enormously. And now I think we need a new idea, like wouldn't it be a great idea for humanity to become creative and have much better social skills?
That strikes me as a very good way to theme next year's dialogue in some ways. So let's build on it. Thank you for that very rich discussion. We haven't produced all the answers. If they existed, we wouldn't be in business. And thank you all for your attention and your questions.
Thank you very much to the panel. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have any questions, please write them down on the notepads on your table with your name and the name of your organization and your question and hand them over to the moderator's envoys circulating in the room. The moderator's envoys will then address the questions to the next panel.